Hi everyone, my name is Chase Porter. I'm a lawyer with Lone Star Legal Aid's Environmental Justice Project, coming to you today on Earth Day 2022 to celebrate that day and talk a little bit about what the Environmental Justice Project does every other day of the year to promote public health and protect the environment around your community. I'm in one of my favorite spots. I'm in the middle of a sprawling park. There's a river behind me here. You never guessed that I was right in the middle of one of the nation's largest cities. I hope that you'll also get a chance this Earth Day to get out and enjoy a little bit of nature around your community as well. This is the 53rd year of Earth Day. It started in 1970 in the middle of a movement in the United States. It started in the 60s where we realized that we weren't really doing what we needed to do to properly protect the environment. Leading up to Earth Day in June 1969, a river much like this one in Ohio, the Cuyahoga River, actually caught fire. Flames went five stories high, several bridges over the river were damaged. It turned out that over the years, large amounts of oily waste and debris had been deposited into the river. And one day, apparently, a spark from a train landed in the river and it caught fire. As tragic as it was one of the most important and influential events in the environmental movement in the United States. And just about a year later, the first Earth Day happened. It's now spread around the world and is celebrated in countries all over the world. Also later in 1970, the Environmental Protection Agency in the United States was created as a result of that movement. The agency is still around today, of course, and they work every day to help protect the public health and environment and communities across the country. As I said, this is the 53rd year of Earth Day. We've come a long way, but I hope that you'll still take a moment today to think about what can I do to continue that movement? What can I do to promote public health and the natural environment in my community? As I said, the Environmental Justice Project, we work year-round to help public health and the natural environment and help communities, especially low-income and marginalized communities, develop and thrive in a fair and equitable way. We offer all sorts of services. Our main goal is to really just be a behind-the-scenes, a support role for communities. We want to empower communities to go out and tackle their challenges on their own. To do that, we offer all sorts of services. We will work with community groups to form. If they would like to get tax-exempt status, we'll help them do that. We'll help prepare bylaws and other governing documents to make sure that the organization is prepared to advocate for its community as well as it possibly can. We work with community groups, and we also work with individuals in all sorts of environmental and community development advocacy. Some of the bigger things and most frequent things we do is comment on permits for proposed facilities or existing industrial facilities in low-income communities. For example, if an oil refinery is looking to expand, it needs to get a permit before it can legally pollute the air. We'll work with a group to file comments on that permit, and if needed, we will challenge that permit in administrative hearings and possibly go to court. We also file civil rights complaints when we think that something has discriminated against low-income people or people of color, intentionally or not. We will work with communities to try to get those long-standing inequities addressed. And like I said, we will go to court sometimes too when necessary. If someone is polluting the air, polluting the water, doing something inappropriate and violating the law. We frequently will comment on the state and federal agencies on their public participation plans. These are their governing documents that that guide the way they, as an agency, engage with the public, engage with people who don't speak English perhaps, or engage low-income communities. We want to make sure that those processes are effective so that every community, especially marginalized communities, have a fair and equitable opportunity to be a part of the decision-making process. A large goal of our advocacy, and something we're going to show you a video about, is obtaining what's called a community benefits agreement. Frequently, it's abbreviated as a CBA. A community benefits agreement is a binding contract between a community group, or it could even be a individual who has their community in mind. It's a contract between them and a private company. It could be the owner of a refinery, the owner of a truck yard, whatever it may be. It's a contract between them that says that that company will support projects out in the community or take measures to mitigate their pollution in the community. In return, the community or the individual who is entered into the CBA will agree, usually, that they won't challenge the permit any further or challenge whatever's going on any further in return for getting those benefits. We're going to go ahead and show you a recorded video now that several of my teammates on the Environmental Justice Project, Amy Dinn and Rodrigo Cantú, where they're going to talk about a CBA that they were able to obtain on behalf of a community group in Pasadena, just outside of Houston. Pasadena is a largely low-income community with many people who don't speak English as well, and we worked with them to challenge a permit, and out of that they were able to secure a number of benefits for their community. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and pass it off to that video and just wish you a happy Earth Day, and I hope you will consider moving forward what you can do to further the environment and public health in your community, and please keep us in mind. As I said, we're always looking for community partners to make sure that we are empowering everyone that we possibly can. Again, happy Earth Day. Thank you.
All right, welcome to today's presentation. My name is Rodrigo Cantú. I'm joined here by the managing attorney of the environmental justice team with Lone Star Legal Aid, Amy Dinn, as well as two representatives of Caring for Pasadena Communities, Yudith Nieto and Patricia Gonzales. And today we'll be talking to you about a case that we worked on together to oppose a permit amendment by Valero regarding its emissions of hydrogen cyanide, or permit 2501A. And we'll talk to you about how this case was resolved. So first, we're going to start with an introduction to the representatives of CPC and briefly talk about CPC's role in the community. We're then going to do an overview of the basics of the most important issues for the community when opposing this permit and how those issues were resolved via a settlement agreement. And we'll talk about what those settlement agreement terms are. We'll then move on to CPC's requesting of help and assistance and knowledge from the community and really requesting input so that CPC can implement projects in and around the Manchester neighborhood that have the support of the residents of that neighborhood. So Yudith and Pat, if you'd like to introduce yourselves and say anything about CPC.
Hi, I'm Pat Gonzales. I'm founder and director of CPC, Caring for Pasadena Communities. Thank you for being a part of this.
Yep, and also I'm Yudith Nieto. I am also an officer with CPC and community organizer and language justice worker.
Thank you, Pat. Thank you, Yudith. So again, Caring for Pasadena Community, CPC, is a 501c3 based in the Pasadena area, serving Pasadena and the surrounding communities in issues of environmental justice and public health. Amy?
Yes, Valero's Houston refinery operates in the subdivision of Manchester with a permit regulated by the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality, TCEQ, which is our state environmental protection agency. The permit amendment that CPC opposed had to do with existing emissions from Valero's Fluid Catalytic Converter Unit, or FCCU, a piece of refining equipment that's used to convert heavy petroleum product into lighter product. There are many pollutants associated with the FCCU, but this permit amendment specifically focused on hydrogen cyanide, more commonly referred to as HCN. HCN is a colorless or pale blue liquid or gas with a bitter almond-like odor. HCN interferes with the body's use of oxygen and can cause harm to the brain, heart, blood vessels, and lungs. Exposure can be fatal. Workers can also be harmed from exposure to hydrogen cyanide. In the last 10 years, the US EPA had realized that pieces of machinery like the FCCU emitted HCN from existing refineries. Valero submitted a permit amendment in 2014 to comply with the EPA's requirement that an emissions limit be set for HCN on an FCCU for any existing refineries like the one in Manchester. So we're going to look a little bit about the process for the permit. How did we get to a settlement? Well, most permit amendments have to go through a process like the one you see on the screen. First, the TCEQ sends out a notice about the proposed permit amendment. Then the public comment period begins, and the public is able to submit comments about its concerns around the permit amendment. Sometimes a public meeting hosted by the TCEQ can take place. In this particular case, there are actually two public meetings because of this interest around this permit amendment. Then, along with comments, interested individuals and groups can submit a contested case hearing request to further challenge the permit in an administrative proceeding before the State Office of Administrative Hearings. This proceeding is a little like a trial about the issues around the permit. After receiving this input, the TCEQ then responds in writing to both the public comments and the hearing request. In this case, CPC was awarded party status in a contested case hearing. That is, the CPC was recognized as an organization with the right to continue to challenge the permit. As you'll see later in the presentation, Harris County, other organizations, and even some neighborhood residents were also granted party status. They all worked to achieve the settlement. This is kind of an overview of the State Office of Administrative Hearings process. CPC had the right to oppose the permit before an administrative law judge because they demonstrated they were represented residents who were affected by this permit. Other parties were able to make the same showing. The contested case hearing is like a trial-like proceeding where the objective is to prove to the judge that the permit Valero put together to regulate HCN does not comply with relevant rules and regulations. Even then, in these types of proceedings, there's risk involved, as the decision by the administrative law judge, even if favorable, wouldn't necessarily be accepted by the commissioners when it goes back to TCEQ. So there was opportunity here to engage in a settlement that could address the community's major concerns about the permit. We're going to now review the major concerns about the permit that were raised through the contested case hearing process and also through the public comments. There are various technical issues that could be addressed by that permit. The most important had to do with setting the limits on the amount of HCN that was emitted from the FCCU. The EPA was requiring limits to be set for hourly and yearly emissions. These limits are important because of the risk to public health. For those that live near a facility, the concentrations and exposures to pollutants over the course of time matters. Further, the amendment also established stack testing, which is a type of test that measures the amount of a particular pollutant or surrogate pollutant emitted from a particular source, here the FCCU. The amount of a pollutant being emitted from sources can vary over time, and the stack test helps verify the pollutants being emitted do not exceed the permit limits and that that equipment is functioning properly. Here, there were two public meetings to discuss the permit in which the public lifted up concerns about this particular amendment and the amount of hydrogen cyanide that the Valero wanted to be permitted to emit. I want to say these were very, very well attended meetings. The public came out to participate here and express these concerns. And these two public meetings are a large part of the success in challenging this permit and getting Valero's attention that what they were seeking was inappropriate. The first meeting was not noticed in Spanish, which led to a second public meeting to be noticed, given that the predominant of residents around this facility speak Spanish. And it was important for that language access justice to have the meetings held in both Spanish and English to ensure they were accessible to the community directly impacted by this permit. The community came out and shared their concerns about the health problems that have been associated with this facility for many years. And the concern about hydrogen cyanide expressed by the community and the amounts that Valero was seeking to permit were legitimate and very important for the community to express. So we thank everyone that came out to that meeting to address those concerns. Some of the concerns that were raised at the public meeting and in writing to the TCQ was that Valero was required to conduct air dispersion modeling. And much of the modeling that Valero shared with the TCQ showed that ground level concentrations of HCN would exceed what are called effects screening levels, or ESLs. CPC and the public raised concerns that Valero's proposed limit would not be as protective of public health as it could be. The permit's health assessment showed that the expected levels of HCN, which would exceed TCQ's long-term health-based effect screening levels by as much as 2.4 times, and the short-term ESL by as much as 3 times. TCQ officials claimed that those levels were so protective that exceeding those levels by 3 times was no cause for concern. The community clearly did not agree. This concern led CPC and many others to challenge the emission limits Valero was requesting for HCN. So let's look at what those limits are. Valero initially requested 512 tons per year of hydrogen cyanide for the limit to be set for this facility. Initially, the TCEQ agreed with and accepted that proposed limit. There were many issues associated with that permit limit at 512 tons per year, as I've just talked about, as far as violating the health effects screening levels. And Valero's actual numbers from a stack test showed that only 49 tons per year of hydrogen cyanide was actually emitted from the facility. Valero had conducted a handful of stack tests already that showed the HCN emissions were much lower than the limit that Valero was actually even requesting. After the sustained advocacy from the community through the public meetings and pressure from the neighborhood and other stakeholders engaged in this permit fight, Valero voluntarily adjusted its emissions limit down to 196 tons per year. However, that limit was still roughly 4 times what Valero's stack test showed as the actual emissions from the FCCU for HCN. So going into the contested case hearing, Valero was still requesting a limit of 196 tons per year. I'm going to turn it over to Rodrigo to tell you how the contested case hearing resulted.
Thank you, Amy. Yes, that was an excellent overview of the community's opposition and what CPC and others were facing going into the contested case hearing process, which, like Amy said, is somewhat similar to a judicial proceeding. So as you can see, CPC was represented by us, by Lone Star Legal Aid, and they were granted party status. We also represented 2 other individual residents of the Manchester neighborhood. In addition to these 3 clients, Harris County was granted party status as well, and they played an important role, as we'll see later in the presentation. There was also another environmental justice group, 501c3 group, that was also granted party status. And in addition to those parties, there were a handful of pro se individuals, meaning they were individuals who were not represented, but they were granted party status because they had submitted comments and they had demonstrated that they would be affected by Valero's requested permit amendment. So after a large negotiation process, CPC reached a settlement agreement with Valero, and other parties, including Harris County, were signatories to this agreement. And the agreement addresses three main areas that are of concern for the community. One, it addresses the limits of HCN that can be emitted from the FCCU. It also requires additional stack testing, and we're going to talk why that is important. And then it also provides for community benefits funds, which CPC will be in charge of, but is very much looking forward to receiving input and help and feedback from the residents of the community, because they want to make sure that projects have your support. So when it comes to setting the limit for HCN, this graphic is can demonstrate very well what the settlement did and what would have been the numbers had there been no settlement and had CPC continue to fight the permit in a forum where there was lots of risk involved. So the settlement establishes 100 tons per year of HCN as the limit. And when it comes to the hourly limit, it actually establishes it as 23 pounds an hour of HCN. If you look to the right, you can see without a settlement, more than likely those terms would have been much higher. More than likely, Valero would have been granted a permit amendment that would have allowed them to emit as much as 196 tons per year of HCN and as much as 48.8 pounds per hour of HCN. So by reaching these numbers, we alongside CPC were able to set numbers that were much lower. And in reaching these numbers, we actually consulted with an expert who was satisfied that numbers like 100 tons per year and 23 pounds per hour were actually very protective numbers. And I should mention that Harris County was particularly concerned about the hourly limit. And why is that? That's because Harris County is actually one of the enforcement agencies. They're one of the agencies that can actually go and visit sites like Valero and conduct tests and analyze documents to make sure that Valero is actually complying with permit limits. And they were very concerned that without an hourly permit, an hourly limit in the permit, it would be very difficult for them to actually do their job and enforce this limit against Valero. So we want to recognize that in working closely with the county, we were able to come up with these numbers, as well as, of course, working with an expert. Now, additional stack testing. As Amy mentioned earlier, stack testing is a test that is done on the source of the pollution, and it measures the amount of particular contaminants that are coming out of that source. And there's, of course, some calculations that can be done to estimate the amounts of other contaminants that are coming out from that particular source of contamination or source of pollution. If there had been no agreement and CPC had continued to oppose this permit, it's very likely that only one additional stack test would have been conducted. That was what the permit required, and that it would have to be conducted within 180 days of the permit being issued. Through the negotiation process, CPC was able to have Valero commit to conducting two additional stack tests. So one in the current year in 2022 and another in next year, 2023, both of these thanks to the settlement. That is important because stack tests collect data, and that data can be analyzed to ensure that the particular unit, the FCCU, is actually functioning properly. So the more data there is, the more assurance that TCEQ and Harris County, and most importantly, the residents of Manchester can have that the FCCU is actually functioning properly. And of course, the settlement also calls for what are called community benefits for the Manchester neighborhood and surrounding communities. And Valero has committed to donating to CPC over the course of 4 years, $100,000. So $25,000 a year for 4 years. Now, CPC has to appoint a committee that will decide how those funds are to be used. And that committee will then implement projects using those settlement funds. And so CPC wants to make sure that Manchester and the residents of Manchester express their opinions about how those monies should be spent, because we know that there are lots of issues in Manchester that need addressing. And this money could be used to address some of those issues. And real quick here, you can see a map that shows the outlines of Super Neighborhood 65, which is the area in which the projects have to be implemented. So we can see the Manchester neighborhood, as well as some neighborhoods just to the west of 610. And so CPC wants to work with the residents of these areas to determine what those projects should end up being. Now, the agreement does sort of categorize what those projects might look like. CPC, by this presentation, is in no way committing to any one particular project. They just want to educate you about those different categories. So the first category actually has to do with beautification in public areas, such as tree planting or landscaping. The second category is relocation assistance, up to $2,000 per household for people who are wishing to move from their home, so long as they are actually the homeowners. The funds do not apply to renters. And finally, the third category allows for donations to local schools. The agreement mentions computers and other educational technology. So CPC is free to spend those these funds in any one of these ways. But CPC does not want to make those decisions without first hearing from the residents of Manchester, because these funds are really for your benefit. And so CPC needs your input. They need your help. They might even need your volunteering hours or your leadership skills in helping to implement those projects. And so they want to hear from you. And if you're willing to sit to be a representative of your community and sit on that committee, they want to hear that as well. And so there's actually a survey that will go live, where you can fill out this survey and tell CPC how you think those funds should best be spent. And on that form, there is also an opportunity for you to let CPC know if you actually want to get involved in that committee and help CPC to implement these different projects using the community benefits fund from this particular settlement. We also did want to take a moment to recognize that there was a flaring event on February 7th, 2022. Reports right now are showing that that flaring event was due to a third-party power outage. And as of right now, purple air monitors in the area are showing that there are elevated levels of particulate matter 2.5. You'll often hear that referred to as PM 2.5. And so we would encourage you to track the data if you're able to on the publicly available websites, and to take steps necessary to protect your health. And events like this, of course, can be very scary because it's often hard to get a hold of data in real time. But we know that when these types of events happen, community residents want to know what they can do to find out information or to raise the issue with local authorities. And so that actually brings us to our next slide, which has to do with the Environmental Nuisance Reporter, which is an application that Lone Star Legal Aid developed alongside a university specifically for the use of community residents. And so you can actually go to our website or go to this, this link here, or even use a smartphone to follow this QR code. And you can actually fill out this app in real time and tell the app about the nuisance. You can even upload pictures. You can be as descriptive as possible about how the nuisance is affecting you. And so we really encourage you to go to this Facebook link to see a tutorial of the app, and then use the app when there are actually nuisance events taking place and you want to track that information. Now, that information gets sent automatically to the TCEQ. And then we here at Lone Star Legal Aid actually will get a copy of that same report. And if there's a particular incident that's very troubling, we can actually reach out to those residents who submitted complaints if they submit those complaints non-anonymously. The app does allow you to submit complaints anonymously, but we would be able to contact you if you do that non-anonymously. And we also have the app available in Spanish for our Spanish-speaking community residents. And with that, our presentation about CPC's opposition to the permit amendment by Valero is concluded. You can see here the contact information for CPC. Yudith and Pat, was there anything else that you wanted to say before we close out the presentation? Pat, I think you might be on mute.
We are looking forward to working with the community of Manchester and surrounding area and hope that we can get as much input as we can from the community so that we can better serve them.
Yes, echo that. And also just a reminder for folks that this couldn't have happened without great leadership of community organizers, community members, and you know, that this goes to show that if we keep pushing and we keep raising our voices and awareness of how to protect our communities, it really does give us the opportunity to create more and better futures for our neighborhoods and our families.
Thank you, Yudith, and thank you, Pat, and thank you for joining our presentation today.